begin as to what I have to say as to what works and how we choose a learning partner, I just want to make a few things very clear. So the first thing is, you know, learning has always meant for me, I've never been able to separate learning development and organizational development. For them, the two are, for me, they're just kind of synchronized. So whatever that you do has to be organization-focused and individual-focused, and that's how the two meet together. So that has been my first premise. The second premise has been, I used to head human resources for KPMG in India, and being a 125-year-old organization at that time, learning programs were kind of forced down our throat. We had X number of mandates that everybody had to go through learning. And the revolt of that came out when I could actually structure something on my own. So it always became to say, learning has to be where there is value at. So that made me kind of really move from a structured kind of, you know, to be done to what is required and what is necessary. So that was the second thing that happened. And third, I must share with you, I was called by my team, my L&D team, to say that we cannot put across any learning partner who has a faint heart. Shalini would tear that person apart. So they were very careful to say who would they bring across, and I have been ruthless, I must admit. Now that I'm on the other side, I realize how difficult it can be for the other person, but I was a ruthless individual when it came to choosing the right person. So Sujaya, thank you for giving me this. It just came to me, but it meant a lot to me. So what I'm going to do is I know I have 15 to 12, 17 minutes. So the first 5 minutes I'm going to spend in explaining what were the nine. We call them the Ganesha's nine for prosperity. So there were nine parameters that we had put in place that we would look at whenever we had to choose a partner. We called it for prosperity because we believe that, you know, learning and development has to bring prosperity. Prosperity of revenue, prosperity of intellect, prosperity of development. So that's the nine mantras. So I will share those nine parameters that we had, which is a quick one. I'll just take about 3 or 4 minutes doing that. And then I'm going to run you through a case study. I believe in experiential learning. So I'm going to run you through to say, what did we do? And for each aspect of what we were looking at, how did we choose a learning partner? Which then kind of gives you a sense to say, why that and why not something else, right? So that's the way I'm going to structure it. So what were the nine mantras? So the nine parameters were, the first one was that a learning partner had to have the ability to understand our context and value add. So how did we do it? The value add had to happen at two levels, for the individual who's being trained and for the organization that is putting in money. So the best way of looking at it was when somebody came and met and we said, okay, so what do you have an offer? And the person would start rattling what they had an offer without asking us to say, what are you looking at? So immediately was eliminated. Second, richness of content. So once we explained to say what we were looking at, what is it that they brought? Was it just a run of a mill? Was it just a cut and paste? Or was there some uniqueness in it? Was there an ability to co-create with us? Was there a learning reinforcement methodology built in? Because I believe in it that you cannot have one session and expect the person to change overnight. It doesn't work. Remember that little thing that you put in to say that magic wand that would? It doesn't work like that. So what were the things that they did as part of the program where this was? So that was our second parameter. And I will run you through you. I can share it over an email. The third thing that we looked at, the facilitator's profile. We have gone to the extent, you know, now I feel awkward about saying this, but I have actually gone to the extent where we have requested the individual who was running a program somewhere to be, we will be a fly on the wall, but we want to see how do you conduct the training. Because it's extremely important to see the person who's going to finally disseminate the information. Is he able to, or is she able to really make that connect and be able to transfer that? So what would you look at per facilitator's profile? Just the range of knowledge. How solid are you in your understanding and knowledge of what you're doing? Your industry experience. We were careful that we picked up people who understood our industry. I worked in the service industry, and believe you me, the kind of people that I worked with would shred, literally shred, a trainer standing there if they did not see that the person really knew what they were talking about, whatever that subject may be, but had to be truly in it. So the knowledge that they brought, the industry experience that they brought. delivery style, like I said, had to be engaging, and adaptability. Because I've seen many a times, a lot of facilitators, we go with something to say, this is what we want to impart today. And actually, what is required is very different. And I must compliment Sujaya for one of the events that I had attended for her. There were many sessions, one after the other, that happened. There was one session where the KPMG, the guy with the pony, what's his name? KPMG organizational head... Nishchay came, and he actually asked the audience first to say, what do you want from this session? We may have whatever we want to talk about, but what is it that you want from this session? And I really thought it helped, because people said what they wanted, and he built around the conversation around that. So adaptability, not just bring what you have to bring. So that's another thing we measured on. The next one was, what is your metrics to measure? And 99% of the people would tell me, we have a feedback form. The feedback form will tell you as to how do you rate. And they were thrown. It doesn't work. So what is the metrics? How do you measure where the person is now and where the person is going to be after that? How will you show there is business improvement results? How do you ensure there's productivity improvement? And I must say, I must have gone through this with hundreds of learning partners. I have only found two till now in mind, where I can vouch to say it works. They have a metrics at the beginning, they have a metrics at the end, which showcases to you to say, these were the people that they went through, this is where they were, and this is where they are after a year, after 2 years. And we gave that much time. You can't expect overnight. A year or two is a reasonable time frame to look at. So that was important. The next was, one size does not fit all. So how will you be able to customize? So let's say you've run this for this, but the next group is going to be a little different within our own constituent. How are you going to make that change? How will you ensure that that works? And adapt the content to business needs. That was very important. So let's say it's just a plain, simple thing called communication. But a communication is very different for an IT person to a person who's doing equity trading. How would you make that change for us? How would you adapt to it? So that was very important. Ability to scale, if you had to roll it out at a large scale, how would you do that? Technology usage that they did, their regional or geographical presence that they had so that they could look at that. Transferability, now we want to own it. We've learned what we had to from you, we want to own it. What is the transferability? We're willing to pay, but we need to be able to do it ourselves. So that we would look at as well. And the last and not the least, the ninth mantra was the moola, which is the pricing. So what is the investment that we are making and what is the quality we would get on that? It was never about return on investment. It was difficult. But what is the quality of the program that we would get? And I always ensured, I remember how much my partners have grumbled about it, but I always ensured 20% of the fee was linked to change. If we did not see it, that 20% did not come to them, because then it is true partnership. And even now when I'm on the other side and I do coaching for CEOs, it's written in the contract very clearly. If you do not find value from this coaching engagement, your check shall be returned. I take 100% beforehand and I return 100% if they don't find value. Thankfully, I haven't had a situation yet, but if it happens, I'm more than happy to provide that back. Because the idea is to value add. Idea is not to just go in and do a program. Just one last one. I was called by a very, very large organization and they said, we want to implement mentorship in our organization. They were willing to pay a huge sum to say, just train our people to become better mentors. And I walked out. I told them, no, it won't work for you. It won't work for me. Because I don't want to have a sleepless night because I'm getting paid when I know it is not going to happen. So these are the steps that you should do to prepare your organization first before you do that. So it helped. They did not go through that, but they gave me something else to do. Right? So it has to be a value add. It has to be a two-way process where both find value in it. So these were the 9 mantras that were there. So now before I move to the case that I want to discuss with you and how did I go about, a very, very important, I think both the people that have spoken till now have talked about it, and I will repeat that again. It is only possible, you can find a true learning partner, and it is only possible if organizations know what do they truly need. If we, as the custodians of the learning and development and organizational development in the organization, do not know what is it that we truly want, how can we really extract it out of a learning partner? So that's the premise with which we started. So now I'm going to share a little work that we did and how did we go about it. I hope you find value in it. Just bear with me for a minute. 2 minutes down my time. So I worked with an organization where we had had a lot of things that had happened. It had acquisitions it had made. The businesses were growing hugely. We had hired indiscriminately from across because we just needed talent. And there was just growth across everywhere. At a point in time, we went back and said, okay, we have all this, but we are not in sync. Everybody's doing well. Everybody's bringing everything. But we are not in sync. So we need to get into sync. So we said, okay, what do we do? What is our need? What should we do? So we said that our organizational context is that we need to have a clear strategic vision which is understood by everybody. That's number one. Second, we need to have our business plans that are in sync with our strategic vision. That's the second. And third, we need to align our workforce to both these, the vision and our business plans. And fourth, we need to build capability so that people have the skill set to be able to deliver on that. Nothing different from what most organizations have, right? You have a vision, you have your business plans, you need people that are going to be delivered on it, and they need to be aligned. Very simple exercise. So this is what we wanted to do. So what we did is, we did it and we started looking around. So the first is, you know, I had done many of those vision mission exercises at KPMG and before that with Chevron, Texaco. There is this blue ocean and there is this and all kinds. I said, no, let's start looking. We must have met close to about 23 to 24 people. Anyone I met at that time, including Sujaya, I remember, I asked, I said, do you have a good person who can do vision mission values for you? Finally, we found one very tiny organization sitting out of US, but we worked with their Japanese counterpart, a fabulous Japanese individual, very, very senior, who actually look at vision and strategy for on a military format. So these are US Marine people that have quit the Marine and actually help you. So what gelled with us? What gelled is that you need a strategy, because before going for war, people need to decide, the generals need to decide to say which way would it go, would we attack or there, or what exactly would we do. But finally, it is that foot soldier on that ground that takes the decision and makes you win or lose the war. So that's what we started with. They did, so we tied up with them for our vision, mission, values. And we tied up with BCG simultaneously, which we looked at all the four consulting, all top-notch consultants on business planning, strategic business planning. We chose BCG because we had a good relationship with them. They understood our organization. Both these partners worked with us for 7 months together. Whether McKinney was working or whether BCG was doing, one of them was always present there because we have to work collectively. So it was not like you do your piece and then somebody else will come and do their piece. So we did the entire vision mission exercise with about top two tiers, all the 16 CEOs that we had and their one level downs. So we did this entire exercise. We figured out to say, where do we want to go? We got BCG. BCG helped us to say, how are you going to do that for each business? Each business then was kind of, the board came into the picture, the board signed off on the entire strategy, all that was done. So that piece was complete. Then what we did after that is we looked at alignment. So McKinney, why we chose them, the second reason was they had this entire tool which helps you cascade it down right to the individual, the last person in your team, as to how the large goal that the function head or a business head has put in will be delivered by the last person. You track it through technology. They have the technology. You track it through that. There is a dashboard that gets presented to the board on a monthly basis, which shows the light to say, where are you moving? So are you 46%? Are you 53%? Where exactly have you moved? And when the whole board is sitting with all 15 CEOs and functionals around, believe you me, when there is one person who's at 35% and the others are at 60, that person is really, really trying to see what best that they can do. So it works. It moves. The whole thing moves. You can actually see the organization moving towards what you have planned to do. So that was one piece that we did. The second piece that we did is with all these partners, we sat down and said, okay, what do we need to do at the organization level and at the capability level? So we figured out to say we will not do hundreds of things. We will only do two or three. So what was the first that came out? On the cultural side, it came out that we need cross-business cohesion. Our people are very good, but they don't talk to each other. They don't work with each other. So that's what we need. So over here, we said, okay, now we need to look at somebody who's able to do. Normally, what do? We do team building exercises. We do adventure-based exercises, right? I said, no. These are egoistic CEOs, very, very egoistic CEOs. They need to be made vulnerable. So we tied up with an organization in Finland. It is run by three blind people. They run. It's called the Tea Party. So we created a room which is completely dark. There is not even a ray of light that comes in. It's a 6-hour program. You do not come out. You use the loo before that, and you're inside there. And you, in that darkness, these people together make, so the boiling water provided, they have to make tea and serve to each other. By the time they came out, and there are certain other exercises that you do, by the time they came out, they knew what it meant to hold each other's hand. So that's the way we picked up to say what would work. When we had to do the same cohesion, one level down, we did not use them. They would not have been effective. So what did we do there? We picked up an organization that looked at 16 competencies. We picked up people from different businesses, and as part of that pro-leadership development program, you needed to have peer coaches. So you had to choose a peer who was from a different business. So that helped in their cohesion. So that's the way we went about the next level. The level below, when we had to look at, we just send them on the run-of-the-mill adventure train. You know, they're young, they want to do all that. And we made them choose. So we picked up three programs and put it for them, and they chose whether they wanted to do extreme adventure, whether they just wanted to do some outbound, or whether they just wanted to do a classroom, whatever worked for them. So that's the way we looked at this piece. The second thing that came out was on open, transparent communication. It came out to say that, you know, people are very good, but they don't talk to each other and do real good. So we tied up and we did three-way conversations. I don't have enough time, but I'll be happy to explain as to how did we go about that entire piece. And a three-way appraisal. So we made it mandatory that one HR person will sit in the appraisal when the appraisal is happening for the two people, just to ensure that the communication was happening. And it was not about to say, aaj baat bahut achhi hawa chal rahi hai. It is about that. So that's what we institutionalized there. On the organizational development side, there were three things that came out. We needed to do technology accreditation, which the IT team picked up and did. We said that we are a very knowledge-based organization, but our productivity is low. So we enhanced our productivity by putting in knowledge management systems so that we weren't creating the same thing again and again. We could just pick it up and start running on it. It saved time. So we looked at time saving, productivity, and knowledge management. So that's what we put in there. And the third last thing that we did is we said we needed to innovate. So normally you run innovation programs. We said, no, we will not do that. We did innovation through exploration. So we put across a full criteria to say how many years have you served with the company, what level are you at, what is it that you can. We allocated money to every individual, and they could choose and do anything they wanted to do with that money. It had to be within that. They just had to send us six lines to say how would it work in the business when they come. If the manager and if the HR agreed to say yes, for example, a person who is looking at technology went and attended an agriculture-related program. There's no connect between the two. But when he put those six lines, you understood to say, okay, how was he looking at, to say, the whole biotechnology in agriculture? And he started that practice for us at after 2 years of that. So that's what we did to ensure that what works for the goose does not work for the gander. So you have to customize. Thank you.